want to tell you guys about something that I found that was pretty cool. Just a little bit about this talk. I'm going to talk about how I got here and, you know, the library that I build. The main thing that I want to cover here is third generation or spiking neural networks, which are asynchronous, which is something I think is pretty exciting. I'm going to talk about why JavaScript is awesome for this kind of neural network. I'm going to do a little bit of hands-on live coding and display of the network, which is inevitably going to go wrong because when you do a live demo in front of people, that's what happens. And talk about learning, how you do learning with an asynchronous neural network and how I use them. Now, before I go into any depth, how many people here don't know what a neural network is? Just want to make sure that I cover that, just in case, yeah. Neural network, so, I'm sure that everybody here has heard about machine learning. Neural networks are one of the types of machine learning, or one of the ways that you can do machine learning. A neural network is something that is modeled on the brain of animals, humans, etc. And essentially it's a bunch of neurons connected by links of different weights. And changing the weights between the neurons can essentially enable the network to learn how to behave. So you can train it to do things. This kind of neural network is a little bit different. I wanted to mention as well, it's okay to interrupt within reason. My talk runs a little bit over the time allocated, so I can cover some things and, you know, it might be good to talk about them if they're relevant, but I don't want to talk too much. What a warning, who here is very familiar with neural networks? Good. Oh, bumper. Two. Alright, so the stuff that I'm showing here is going to be very different from what you've done before if you're using neural networks. So just keep an open mind. Something a bit different. A little bit about myself. Let me use this magic thing here. So I started with my first computer when I was 8 years old. ZX Spectrum 128Ks of RAM. Pretty powerful stuff. Wasted my youth in playing computer games. And I got a taste of coding pretty early on. Programming BASIC. 10, print below, 20, go to 10. Hard stuff. Now, a couple of late 90s, I started building websites because that's what you do. I spent the noughties doing web development, and I can tell you that JavaScript development back then was far less sexy than it is now. Middle of the browser wars, and the technologies were okay, but they weren't as amazing as they are nowadays. Now, come 2010, things are starting to change a bit in the landscape, and you guys probably have been part of this. We get Node.js happening, and Angular, you know, some technologies like PhoneGap, mobile, cloud, JSON API, suddenly JavaScript starts becoming sexy. Come 2015, I've done a fair bit of work in JavaScript and coding, but I'm starting to want to do something a bit different, so I start learning about it up front, just teaching myself in my spare time. Come to Melbourne and I do some work, I start basically getting involved with NodeBots, which is another meetup, where you build little robots like this and they run on JavaScript. Basically learn how to build little robots. And, you know, in NodeBots you can make them compete against each other. It's incredibly geeky. That's a lot of fun.
Sumo,
yeah. So basically the aim is to push the other guy out. Spoils kind of lifting as well. So you push the other robot out. Now, come 2017, this is me. I'm a JavaScript developer by day and a map tinkerer by night. Creating robots. And I've built a few robots. So a robot, it's got some sensors and I want it to move. So I kind of decided it was a bit boring to just tell it where to go. I wanted it to move by itself. More specifically, I wanted it to avoid obstacles and move towards the light. And I've got two little robots here. As you can see, one of them has a solar panel on top. And I wanted him to be able to feed himself, basically, recharge its own battery. So to head towards places that have more light. The basic premise of what I was trying to achieve is we got some sets of data going into a brain of some kind, and the actions come out and movement. And I've got a whole bunch of sensors in these guys, and I just needed to do a bit in the middle. Now, you know, whenever I've got a situation like this, I try my own stuff. My first attempt was a relational matrix. So imagine as a, you know, kind of like an Excel spreadsheet with like actions on top, inputs on top, and then outcomes on the side. it worked in the fashion, but it wasn't a very good solution, so I kind of gave up on it after a while. Main problem with it is input-output, so if you don't take into account all the context, all the other things that are going on, you just take into account a single input, it doesn't work very well. Don't take context into account. Alright, so got to a point where I thought, okay, well, let's see what other people have done. Way too much stuff out there. Like, if you try and dip your finger into machine learning, it's just like way too much. It sent me to sleep, and none of it was very relevant to my particular problem. So I thought, okay, well, what about game AI? I've got something closer to what I was aiming for. I want something to become alive in a sense and move around its environment. That led me to this guy called Steve Grand, who created a video game in the 90s called Creatures. Very similar to what I was trying to achieve. These little creatures live inside your computer. They feed, they interact with each other, they talk, they mate. They're basically alive inside your computer. He wrote a book about it as well, which I thought was pretty cool. I like his philosophy as well. It was like something way out there, pretty zen. So he basically said that life, and he was trying to recreate life inside a computer, it's a set of patterns that persist longer than others. Very zen stuff. It kind of influenced my work down the line. As I started to investigate neural networks, which are pretty painful if you start to get into them, they're very complex now, I thought, okay, well, instead of trying to research all this stuff, it's pretty dry material, I'll just build my own, because I'm a coder, so this is what I do. When I want to understand something, I build it from scratch. It kind of led me to something like this. My first attempt at a neural network, and I put a little display over it. JavaScript is great, because there's so many libraries out there that allow you to display stuff. And this is what I was getting, what are all those weird patterns? I just created a neural network and it's blinking like the Christmas tree.
Is that some kind of a state machine?
I don't know. What's a state machine? It's just a bunch of blinking lights. Right, so then I looked at the classical neural networks, and I found that there was this distinction between the second and third generation neural networks. Second generation neural networks are very good at things like image recognition. Information is encoded in connection waves. So we've got all these things, all these neurons, and all these links between them, and you get some input like an image and some output like, that's a 1, or that's an A, or that's a person eating a sandwich. There's no weird patterns in them. And they're very different to the way that real neurons inside your brain or inside the brain of an animal. Now, this is more what real neurons are like. Information is actually encoded not in the weights. I mean, it is encoded in the weights, but more importantly, it's encoded in patterns of signals. This is quite a leap, because we're talking not just about connection weights, but time. It's called third generation spiking neural networks, which I kind of built it, and then I found it afterwards. Now, with neural networks, we've got this thing, these nodes. They're like cells, and they link together by these links. And it's a signal that travels from one to the other. Not always. Sometimes the links aren't strong enough to propagate the signal, but sometimes the link is strong enough to create a signal that travels through. These signals are generally electrical in our brain, but they can also be chemical. And all these originate from a primordial soup where there was just cells sitting around. And they were, communicating, sending signals to each other, and, eventually this is how they organize themselves. Now, the main point I'm trying to make here, which I'm not making very well, is that signals travel slowly. I'll ask a question here. I've kind of given it away already. How fast do you think a signal travels through your brain? Pop quiz.
Now,
you go for
light. <Whose brain? laughs>
So, is it the speed of light? Is it a racing car? Is it a person walking or running? Or is it an airplane? Now, I would have thought that it's pretty fast. If you think about all these neurons, they're electrical signals, so it has to be electricity. Electricity travels at the speed of light. Yeah? Let's look at how a neuron fires. We get an initial stimulus in a neuron. This is like an electrical signal that pings one of my neurons. When it gets strong enough and it goes above a threshold, suddenly it goes bang. You get something a bit called a chain reaction. It takes a whole millisecond for that chain reaction, the potential to build and become strong enough to fire the next guy. This is 1 millisecond. 100 milliseconds. So, bit of maths. If it takes a millisecond to fire the next guy, I can do 1,000 guys in 1 second. Yeah? It really depends on the distance between neurons. Inside your brain, they're 1 millimeter apart. Down your leg, they're like 10 centimeters or half a meter apart. So the answer is this. Inside your brain, they actually go really slowly. Down your leg, they travel fairly fast, but they don't go anywhere near the speed of light. And the main reason for this is because they're asynchronous. Because you get all these neurons firing, the signal travels to the next guy, it gets there eventually, but before it gets to the next guy, there's all the other ones that are firing at the same time. This is what it looks like. Spiking neural networks are actually asynchronous. And there's, you know, a few articles out there that talk about this, how second generation artificial neural networks are biologically inaccurate. Now, they're actually more useful for machine learning because there's a lot more of them out there, a lot more examples, but they don't model biology very well. Spiking neural networks do, however, they generate all these spikes. Now, I just want to mention here, humble sea slug. Some people have studied these guys. They make it their lives to study sea slugs. Now, if you look at the foot of a sea slug, the pedal ganglion, which is a bit of the brain of a sea slug that deals with the movement, triggers a muscle contraction that travels downwards. And this happens over and over. Now, some people have studied the brains of sea slugs, and they found that a large percentage, sorry, not the brains, just the pedal ganglion, look at the movement. A large percentage of neurons are actually oscillators. That means that you hit one of them and the signal just travels back and forth. Some of them are pulses. If you hit that neuron, the traveling back and forth stops. And some of them are called bursters, which means it creates a burst of a signal and then it stops. That's how they move. Now think about this type of neural network when you have to create a complex series of time signals. They're ideal for something like muscle movement. Now the main takeaway for me here, and sorry to dump all this theory on you, is that if I want to create a real brain inside a robot, I need an asynchronous neural network. And guess what?
Everything is awesome. Everything is cool when
you now, the cool thing about JavaScript is, you know, asynchronous, it just comes out of the box. You do a little set timeout inside your neuron firing method, and it just happens. You know, you don't need to think about it. Easy. It's my second attempt at building a neural network. Now, I did it in 3D because I managed to get more neurons on the screen. But it looks like you can see here, I don't know if you guys can see it at the back, signal's kind of traveling, sorry it's moving so much, but the signal basically travels from one end to the other. This is some refinements that I did later on. Something interesting that I found is depending on the shape of the network, the signal propagates differently. So this guy is kind of a kidney shape, goes round and round, it's a ring, it goes round and round. I just wanted to show you very briefly how you create a neural network in code. It's actually not too hard. Now here's an example of a very basic network. I've got some nodes, they're the fat guys, and then I've got some lint between them, they're the thin guys. Now, some connections are stronger, some are weaker. And basically what we have is an array of nodes, as you can see there. Can you guys see clearly? We've got an array of nodes. We've got an array of links. And each one of the link goes from one node to another node. And it's got a weight. That's a neural network. The basic thing is it's not actually that hard. But visualizing it makes it really easy. Otherwise, we don't know what the hell's going on. I can add some more links here on my network. So I can link, you know, like 2 with 5. And then we've got an extra little bit of a change there. Showing 3D. Now, you make this big enough, and you get all these other examples that I showed you earlier. Alright, where was I? Yes. Now, I mean, this is the thing, it's all fine and good. Actually, one more thing that I wanted to show you before I run on to that bit is what does it look like when you build upon that model a little bit more? once I build on that model, here we go. So I've got the same thing as I showed you before, but a lot more complex. I automated a function that created all these links between them. Now, this kind of network is asynchronous, which means that signals travel from one end to the other. If I click this guy, that's number 22. Can you see that? It travels. The traveling signal.
Does it travel to all the parts which are associated with that one?
Well, not all the parts. The strongest parts, if the path, like if the link, connection link there, goes above a certain threshold, then it travels that way. But below the threshold, the signal just stops. So you've got to reach a certain potential, a certain like level, to trigger the next node in the chain reaction. And for it to learn, you just shift all those weights so that you get the outcomes that you want from the inputs that you're putting into the network.
So it always chooses one node, the next node which has got the highest.
No, not quite. It goes travels through, picking as many nodes as it can find. It's not just one. I mean, there's different ways of doing it, but the way that I did it, it just kind of travels right through. So it finds a variety of nodes and would.
One to many.
Whatever it's associated to, and it's strong enough to trigger the next guy, then it'll find.
It always seems to be going in the same direction. Is that just a consequence of the weights?
Yeah, so that's a very good question, and thank you for raising it. So this kind of network that I did is biased in one direction, but depending on the shape of the network, the signal will travel differently. Now, this example that I did here is a tube shape, which I did kind of picking nodes in a forward direction at random. That's why you get this weird shape, but it's still in one direction. I did some examples here in code. So the tube shape has a forward bias, and then it just adds, wherever you are, adds a little bit of a forward bias. I do a bowl shape, which is just the target is a random item in the network. We get something that looks like a bowl. And interestingly as well, when you trigger one of the nodes in the bowl, you get the Christmas lights. That's a Christmas show. There's another example that I did there, which was ring shape. Yeah, so the ring shape is the same as the tube, but it links back to the beginning. That's what that one looks like, the ring shape. And if you trigger one of them, yeah, signal that looks around and around. Now, I'm not sure about this, but I have a guess that this is what happens in our brain, because our brain has waves that can be detected, different waves when you're asleep than when you're awake. You're meditating, different waves. So I think this is the shape of thoughts inside our brain, but then I'm not absolutely sure. I've just tried to model the neurons as they are biologically as much as possible. Now, this is the really hard stuff, actually. I've got this neural network, the signal's propagation along it. How do I get it to learn? Now, basically, some connections need to become stronger and others weaker, so you get a particular outcome. So over time, you'll get something like this. I don't know if you guys can see at the back, the connections are growing stronger. So that's what I'm aiming for. There's two different learning models for neural networks. And if you do stuff with neural networks, there was a couple of guys here that mentioned they've done neural networks before. Probably heard about batch propagation. This is the stuff that makes my head hurt. Thankfully, reinforcement is simple. Batch propagation, if you ever try it on an asynchronous neural network, which has a signal that travels right through, or sometimes two or three signals that travel alongside each other, it's almost impossible. In batch propagation, so anyway, I'll talk about reinforcement, which is conceptually really straightforward. You try some random stuff, your robot's going there, boom, bump against the wall. You want to decrease the incidence of bumping itself on the wall, so you decrease the connection weights that were associated with bumping into the wall. Oh, so I'm blindly moving around. Oh, I've gone into a room that has some lights. I want to reward the robot so it does that more often. You increase the connection weights along those paths. Now that's pretty simple stuff. Backpropagation is different. Backpropagation is where, say for example, you've got an image of a 1 and a 1, and then you want to change the connection weights backwards, some really weird maths, calculate something called the loss function, which is what's the ideal set of connection weights that lead to that outcome. But you need to know your outcome to begin with. The blind robot moving around the house, it's going to be pretty hard to know the outcome unless you do a simulation of your house. Right? I mean, the main answer here is backpropagation doesn't matter that much. Alpha zero, have anybody heard about alpha zero? So this is the current AI chess champion in the world. He's just beaten another AI at chess in December. He made it all over the like it was all over the headlines. He uses a general reinforcement algorithm. So I thought, okay, well, if this guy uses a general reinforcement algorithm, it's okay. I don't need to do that. This is boring stuff. It's just the way that you've been doing learning. And there's a difference between short-term and long-term memories, which I probably won't go into detail. Now, let's make some music. I mean, let's try the demo. This is the bit that's not going to work. All right, so I'm going to try and create some music with a neural network. I'm going to start from just the plain neural network. In here, I've got Node running. So this is Node from the command line. Now, I use the command line. This is kind of like the server part of the application. I can connect via USB to some, you know, to some hardware. There's also a client component of it, which is what we're going to use to visualize it. And that's a browser, because it's Node, and it's easy to do this stuff. But here, we're visualizing the stuff that I'm just running from the command line. This is a network. I click one of these guys. The signal's traveling one direction. You can see the signal's traveling there. Now, the way that learning happens, I tell it that it's done whatever it's done, doing it well. I don't know if you guys can see that the connection weights are getting stronger, but anything that's fired recently is getting stronger. Can you guys see that? So that's the basis of learning. You know, something's happened, we've got a good outcome. Well, it doesn't propagate. Now we're going to put a bit more stuff in here. This is the code underneath that network, creating a new neural network with 120 nodes, capable of drawing a certain learning rate and signal speed. I'm going to do some outputs here. These are going to be musical notes, just to illustrate what you can do. And whenever it hits one of those musical notes, it's going to make a sound. So we've got the same network here, but we've got some red dots appearing on one side. Can you guys see that? Mm-hmm. Now this is F1. That's E1. E1. Now they're all connected, interconnected, so sometimes you get a bunch of signals instead of just the one. If I go on this side, which is the side where you trigger the signal, you get different patterns depending on where the signal comes through and the weights associated. Signal.
Sorry, what are the red nodes?
The red nodes are the outputs. So whenever you hit, whenever the traveling signal travels through all these neurons, and it hits a neuron that's involved in, you know, in reality in our bodies, this is a muscle. You know, it's like, boom, it's moved a muscle. You twitch. The twitching here is a musical note. So it's like linked to an output, which is a musical note. I'm going to do a little bit more in there. I'm going to create some inputs which fire randomly every 500 milliseconds. I run the same guy. Start visualizing the signals traveling through. So depending on which one of these it hits first, sometimes you get multiple signals at the same time. Thank you. learning. This is a very simple learning model. I don't know if you guys can read this code, but I'm saying if you hit a C1, learn. If you hit an E1, unlearn. If you hit a G1, learn. If you hit an A1, unlearn. So it's going to prefer some nodes over others. Now what you'll see here is that this stuff that I'm doing manually by telling it that it's doing well, can you see the neuron, the links becoming stronger? So going to happen automatically now, because it's just learning automatically instead of me clicking the button. I don't know if you'll be able to see the connection, it should just automatically appear.
You can see it here on this screen, but that one doesn't show things as clearly.
And what you'll get here is over time, it'll prefer some notes over others, so we'll just keep those more often. It's not a very complete example, but it gives you an idea of what learning is. You encourage certain pathways and you discourage other pathways. I've actually got negative links in red that discourage the next guy from firing.
Usually in traditional neural networks, in synchronous neural networks, you have a loss function to understand how good neural networks.
Backpropagation,
It's different, but basically you give input signal, you predict value, and then you calculate how far the values, the predicted values far from the result. In your case, how do you estimate how deep neural network can learn itself?
Because it does some things.
Is there any quantitative way to...
Let me show you. So I've got another example. Actually, sorry. I've just got connected devices. I've got here... this is a little Arduino. Anybody here familiar with Arduino? Arduino is a microcontroller, so you use them for manipulating electrical signals. In this case, I've got a little accelerometer that can tell which way's up and which way's down. I'm going to connect it via USB and use a library called NodePods. A little light thing to get it signal. Now, all I want now is just to show that the accelerometer is working. So here I've got. Can you see those numbers up there? Now at the moment it's telling me that Z, which is this axis, is very strong negatively. If I turn it the other way around, Z, which is this axis, is strong positively. If I turn it on the side, you'll see that X becomes strong. If I turn it in the other direction, X so this is basically an accelerometer. It's 6 degrees, 66 directions tells you which way the robot is standing. If it falls over, then it knows that it's fallen over because those numbers change. Now, to answer your question, and this is where, you know, demos... it works. I'm going to tell it... I'm going to get it to tell us which way it's heading. Yeah? Now, the way you know your network is successful is because do we have sound?
Right.
At the moment, the network has no idea which way's up, which way's down, which way's left, which way's right. Yeah? It's supposed to be up. It's got no idea. Now,
right.
It's not very, like, I'm not doing backpropagation. You can't train it as you would normal neural networks, but you know that this is not left and this is not down. This is supposed to be up. So it's just by observation, really.
Right.
Now, if you train this network for long enough, it'll actually start saying up, 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 up. And when you turn it over, it'll start saying down, 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 down,
right.
down, down.
Yeah,
takes about 5 minutes.
Right, right, yeah, up, yeah, down.
I could keep going with the recitation until it learns, or I can just show you a network that I've trained already.
Right,
let's load a network that is trained already. But in a way, you know, aren't humans the same way? You know, when a kid sticks his fingers in the electricity socket, you know, that's not good. And when, you know, they've done their homework on their own, then you know that's good. So it's by observation, really. And you just keep trying until you observe what you're after. So they can be trained. They need a lot of repetition to get to what you want. And in a way, they're like children as well, because, you know, even after they got it right, they can still change their mind and start saying down when it's up. And you just got to encourage them to say up when it's up and down when it's down. Or to turn left when they should do, or to head towards the light when they should do. So it's just by repeating the encouragement over and over again, by telling the child, you know, please do your homework, please do your homework, please do your homework. Eventually they'll get there. Okay. Does that answer the question about learning? Now, I've skipped all the crazy maths about propagation. I feel a little bit bad because I didn't go into the depth of it, but I thought, it's okay. You know, like, what other algorithms use in forcing science? Where am I? Now, talked about a bit of applying it to hardware, which is that's a bit of hardware there. And the next bit that I want to show you, well, we've just seen that demo there. And these are all the other kind of sensory inputs. Now, the next piece that I wanted to show you is robots. And this is inevitably going to go wrong because it's a real demo with live little guys. But I have two of them because one of them will inevitably fail, so the other one will be okay. Right, so I'm just powering them up. Now, these guys contain a little Arduino, same as this guy. This one, I don't know if you guys can see very well. There's an Arduino there, another one there. And here I've got a Raspberry Pi, which is basically a small Linux computer. So, you know, here I've got my Windows or Linux computer, and then I've got a microcontroller. Here I've got a computer and a microcontroller. The microcontroller's job is to manipulate all the electronics. The computer's job is to talk via the Wi-Fi, and to do the computation and to run the programming languages like JavaScript that make the magic happen. Right. Now, because these are two computers, that one there's a Raspberry Pi, but it's a nano, it's a tiny Raspberry Pi. Now, because these are Linux computers, you can actually just HTTP to them and SSH to them and all that. Mm-hmm. There we go. 88 is this guy. Let's see if he works. You can see there, taking him in a high zero. This is nuts. This one I call Mr. Should be on. He's moving backwards. He gets a bit scared if he hits a wall, but sometimes he thinks when he's walking in front of him, they're probably just going to end up moonwalking.
Where the end is, there's a wall there.
Or maybe there's something wrong with the sensors that I've not defined.
It's not supposed to mingle, by the way. No information from the range sensor.
Probably because something's not been. I'm
not getting power anymore. Sorry, demo's not going to work. It's inevitable. But this one might be. The problem there is it's activated this collision avoidance because I'm not getting any information from the range, the little ultrasound thing in the front. So if you can see here, range, it's saying zero. So it's doing collision detection. It's thinking that it's going to bump himself into a wall. So that's no use. Is number two working?
How do you know how many nodes you have to have in a neural network to teach your robot certain things?
It depends on the complexity of the task. Hold on. The complexity of the task, and how many sensors it's got, how many outputs. So this guy only has two outputs, motor, and it's got about 10 different inputs. I'm getting range data. Good. Alright, so let's look at Mr. Ping Pong. Put that back on. Alright, so he's going to roam around now. We're looking at Mr. Ping Pong's brain. These two red dots you see over there are the motors, left and right. The signals are coming in from the blue dots. Range finder. Other sensors, some Wi-Fi. Yeah. So that's what I use the network for. Not a very good example. He's running very close to the limit at CPU. He's got trouble showing the full range of neurons firing. But that's basically the.
What is it learning and unlearning at the moment?
At the moment, not much. So it starts from a flat. A flat network where every single node is got the same strength, and it's very low strength. It's only when you get certain outputs that are desirable that it'll start reinforcing those. What it's supposed to learn is it's supposed to head towards the light. And it's also supposed to avoid obstacles. So whenever the rangefinder gets close to something, it should be avoiding it before it triggers a collision avoidance.
What sensor is it using to work out where the line?
I've got some photo resistors. So there's one there, and one at the back. So in theory, when the ones at the front are getting a high light signal, it should hit towards the light.
Maybe you feel the light is kind of even.
Yeah, over here it's not much different. Anyway, I just wanted to show you how I use them, how I use the neural network. It's not particularly successful. The learning algorithm is not hot, but I just wanted to show you the concept of an artificial neural network. It's, that one didn't work. Okay.
Have you found that certain shapes of neural networks are better at learning to learn?
I found some shapes are actually really fascinating because they keep the signal keeps traveling over and over, and it travels through different pathways on each iteration. So, an example, which is that
the ring.
For example, the rings. So, if we look at the one that was playing music at the beginning, and we give it a ring shape. Around. Among the learning its creation pathway that is nothing, so it's so you get signals like that loop around, and sometimes several signals looping around at the same time through slightly different pathways. Eventually this will create something like that. Strong signals that will generate a melody. So some shapes are really interesting, and there's a big difference here between this kind of neural network and traditional neural networks, which are more shaped by layers, and the signal only travels in one direction, or the calculations are performed in one direction. Now, before people fall asleep on me, I want to talk quickly about what I learned. Normally when I do this project, there's a whole bunch of stuff that I learned. I want to talk about typed arrays. How many JavaScript developers here? How many of you guys have used typed arrays? They are awesome, for performance reasons. Now if you do a traditional array, JavaScript has this downside in which every number in your array is stored with 8 bytes, which is a waste, because 60,000 synapses take up a space of half a megabyte, which is a lot to transfer down the wire. Use a U-Link 8 array, 8 times smaller, 8 times faster across the wire. So my network, so when I'm transferring all the weights in the network, it's 60K instead of half a megabyte. That's better for performance. And WebSockets transfer this information at the byte level. Amazing, it just works out of the box. I use Rollup as well. I don't know if any of you guys have used Rollup. So probably there's a few Webpack uses here, I imagine. Rollup is kind of a similar thing, but for packaging libraries as opposed to applications. This is a library, so that's pretty cool. Performance, I'm doing some... I found that for loops are slightly more performant than functional constructs like for each map and reduce. They're not as handy, obviously. Bit of WebGL, if the network was done in WebGL 3D. Now, I don't recommend you try 3D physics, it's bloody hard. Just use 3JS. And if you show too much stuff, it's just going to kill the browser, so try and hide it. WebSockets, they're ideal for this kind of setup, where you've got a single client and a single server. The data transmission is pretty low level, so it's very efficient, but it's not so good when you've got many clients. JSON can be gzipped across the wire, and socket IO does it automatically for you. And there's also some type of messages which can be volatile. That means that if it doesn't reach the destination, it's okay. And when you've got like thousands of blinking lights happening at the same time, it's okay if you miss out some of them. Neural networks. They used to be scary. They're not scary anymore for me. It just knows the links, and each link has a weight to the next node. Asynchronous neural networks create pretty beautiful patterns. Use signal accumulation, which is very powerful. I found that reinforcement was enough for me, at least. I might try and study the loss function and backpropagation, but I'm not really looking forward to it. And JavaScript is very well suited to this kind of network. I just want to comment briefly about machines taking over, because this is a sort of machine learning talk. Now, I love Elon Musk. Bits, but there is one thing that I disagree with him. I don't think the singularity is coming anytime soon. It may just be my experience, but what I built is somewhere between a jellyfish and a sea slug in terms of number of neurons in computation. So 150,000 synapses. So probably at the boundary level of what I can achieve is somewhere between the sea slug. Now, I feel that realistically, with this kind of network, I could achieve something that that could model the brain of an ant. Each animal down this scale, we sort of go up an order of magnitude higher. Humans, obviously not every human has the same amount of neurons. It doesn't feel very realistic because we've got 150 trillion synapses in our brain, and if you've got to store information for 150 trillion synapses, we're talking about petabytes of RAM. If you have to go an order of magnitude above, which is what I would imagine an AI has, you know, it's like hundreds of petabytes. Just something crazy. And that would be using C++ and JavaScript. So, there's some things that I'd like to investigate, RustLang, I'm interested in. I'd like to aim for the artificial general intelligence of an ant with about 100,000 neurons, which I could achieve in a Raspberry Pi. Some other things that I'd like to explore in more examples. And some closing thoughts. I've talked about spiking neural networks, also because they're asynchronous. I feel they have heaps of potential, but they're not really ready for prime time yet. They're perfect, or I feel they're perfect for bringing robots to life using sensor information, and the JavaScript language is very well suited to this kind of approach. But if you have a business problem, probably go for a standard artificial neural network because they're going to be more mature and there's a lot more literature out there that will help you solve your business problem. Something like Python's more useful. That's it for me. Thank you very much, everyone.
Performance-wise, have you thought about using C?
I have thought about it. I might not go for C. I would use RustLang instead of C.
Okay, something else besides JavaScript.
Yeah, it might help. JavaScript is not very memory efficient, and you know you've only got one thread that you can use instead of multiple threads. On a Raspberry Pi, this Raspberry Pi is a full-size Raspberry Pi. That one's only got a single core, but this one's got four cores. I can't use the full power of the four cores, which I would be able to with another more low-level language. So yeah, I have thought about it. It's just once I step over that boundary, I have to solve the problems in that space. At the moment, I'm solving problems in JavaScript pretty quickly. I think once I have to, you know, use something different.
What about JavaScript to C compiler?
Maybe. Is there one that you know?
I can Google it.
There is a example of that.
It's a good idea. I mean, that would be ideal because then I could fill some problems in JavaScript that got the rule pattern.
Can you read that? Most of the second generation of the very old data that is very suited to the GPU type of precision. Can you imagine?
I feel the main problem at the moment isn't performance so much as how to utilize the Christmas lights show. I think it could, obviously. I mean, you could just have just firing signals over the four threads and somehow maintaining the state as the signals travel through. It's more, I think the main problem with this kind of neural network is finding a use case for it. I think it would be ideal for something like muscle control. You know, if I take something out of my pocket, imagine how many muscles are involved in that action. I just triggered it from my mind, but I involved a whole bunch of muscles in my arm and a very intricate timing of each one of those signals. I feel that a synchronous neural network would be ideal for this kind of problem or this kind of solution, but they're pretty new and they don't have a lot of practical use right now. Sorry, does that answer the question? I'm not sure if it does. I think it could be possible, but not with JavaScript, obviously, or hard, pretty hard with JavaScript. It would have to step into you know, something like C or Rust, etc. But I feel the main obstacle to overcome with this kind of network is the use case.
Presumably a natural neural network has creation and destruction of the parts. Like it looks like you initially seed a bunch of random sort of shapes and things and then learn the connections between it. But is there a mechanism, do you think, that you could incorporate where the actual neurons get eventually destroyed or inserted?
That's a really good point. I think there's a new type of neural network that somebody was talking about in a meetup recently that does exactly that. So as it learns, it generates new connections between neurons. I haven't explored that possibility, but I think it's got a lot of potential. I'm starting here with like 16 connections per neuron, and I'm just shifting the weights as I go. But it is quite possible to just generate new connections as we go.
In your asynchronous neural network, the interval between different layers are fixed, or it's random value?
You can set it, so I've expressed it in terms of how many neurons per second it can travel. The default that I put here is 20, but if you want to double the speed, then you do 40 neurons per second, and the signal will travel faster.
Okay, but...
Does that answer the question, sorry?
I just try to understand, so what's the difference between a normal neural network? Because between each layer, you would just add some latency. So each is...
Yeah, so in here, you're adding latency between layers. That's sort of the short answer. Not just that, okay.
But where is the value into adding latency between layers?
The patterns.
But
the
I guess... Let's say, so your circle pattern, if you do it synchronous way of, you just set your interval to zero, you max out the CPU and you just do the same again and again.
Setting it to zero would still be asynchronous, because in JavaScript a set timeout with a zero will still kind of put the next thing on the queue and then would pick it up when it's available.
Yes.
A synchronous neural network would be one where you do the computation from one end to the other, without any, just in one go. So automatically you've got a result.
I mean, on the circle one, you are connecting your output to your input.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
You wouldn't be able to if it was synchronous, you just create an endless loop. It's like a while loop that doesn't end.
But even when it's asynchronous, it will still create an endless loop.
If it's synchronous, it would be the same as doing a while loop without ever existing. I'm not sure whether I answered the question.
I just don't see, like, if I do it in C, the same program, let's say, and just between each layer to do the matrix calculation, I will add some latency, I will add a sleep. My C program is synchronous, but it does the same as...
I guess it goes back to Stephen's point about trying to find the uses for these things. I think the problem you're having is not seeing the use for it, which is kind of what Stephen's point is, on the sense of it's finding the benefit of having those things, and that's the bit that is unknown.
Yeah, I tried to use music to express it. Now, the human ear is highly tuned to not just the notes, but the order of the notes and the duration of the notes. It wasn't a very good example right there, but... Eventually, you could compose something like music that has a very intricate timing of signals that are repeated over and over again.
Just the timing will always be the same because the interval is the same.
Yeah, but as you learn, you can change the timing of the signals and the patterns.
Yes, but it's in your learning loop anyway, so the path in each loop might be different. Still, just adding an interval. If the interval is fixed, won't add anything else. That's it.
The use for it is not obvious. I think that's the main sort of hurdle with this kind of network at the moment. Sorry, were you?
Yeah, just in terms of the timing, the only reason why it seems to be a crab time is that you want to be actually visualized the actual neural network when you actually see it. Also, if you're doing something like music, you need sort of intervals between the things. But if you're trying to do something like facial recognition or something like that, you wouldn't necessarily go for something like the time.
Yeah, this is not a good
And thing. In that case, let's say, for example, like programming a bot took 5 minutes to learn how to figure out what light was. And if you basically didn't do that with any delays at all, if you just basically let the program run, how long would it take to figure out where the light was?
It's different because with traditional second generation neural networks, you give it training data So you give it all the different examples that it's likely to encounter, and you know how it's meant to react on each of those examples. Here it's different. The robot is moving as it's learning. So, yeah, I don't know if I've answered the question.
No. Well, it's just, yeah, if you basically take time out of the equation, and then learning something like facial recognition, or learning something like how to pick up a piece of music or something like that, what the time of the learning? I guess it would depend on the CPU and the RAM and all that sort of stuff, but
With traditional neural networks, you train them. So you like, you know, the AlphaZero, they spent 4 hours crunching on a supercomputer to be able to come up with the set of options that are ideal for most chess situations.
Right.
So that's it. You just train it over and over and over again. And all that training happens synchronously, from one end to the other happens synchronously. It's just one after another.
Right.
Now, with this, I don't think that you could use this for chess, to be honest. It's not a good problem.
Yours is asynchronous, it could even be faster.
Yeah, and it would take a lot longer as well, because you'd have to incorporate time into it, how long it takes for somebody to move, etc. So I don't think that it's not ideal for that kind of problem. It's more, I guess, ideal for modeling biological organisms, or the responses of biological organisms to their environment.
But for example, with a sensor, you have a time delay.
So, yeah, I keep checking the sensor. So every 100 milliseconds, it says the sensor gives me some data. Okay, it's light or it's dark. And then I feed that into the network.
How you're modeling biological organisms. I think it'd be interesting to see if you can put like preference in there, right? So you've got it moving towards life and just get like receptive, so you're reinforcing that behavior, but then does it prefer yellow light versus red light type scenario?
Yeah, the way to do that, I mean, if you can differentiate between those types of light, would be just how you create its learning behavior. So basically, you read the sensor, you find yellow light, you reward it, you get red light, then tell it not to do that. So normally, the neural network would exist within a program that reinforces certain patterns of behavior. And that's, I think, what you're talking about. It's not just a network, it sits in an enclosed environment that reinforces particular behavior.
Being a robot, did you try simulating this on a computer? And I guess
I've thought of it.
Yeah. Only because they're talking about like training time, so it's like big computer, and maybe
it's hard. I've thought of it, but it's a lot of work to try and simulate your environment. I haven't attempted it yet. I prefer to let the robot run around. This is fun as well, playing with every.
And if it tries to take over, you put it back.
That's it. Yeah.
Don't scan it.
Yeah, just keep
it. Bam!
And you go, Don't kick it. Just turn it over. So thank you, everyone.
Sorry, I think I've gone the way ahead of time. Alright, should we have a break, maybe? Do you want to go, by the way? Have a short break and then come back.